Hello everyone, I'm Hoshi, it's 2015, I played some games, some are good, some are bad, awesome. I have here a list of games I've played that I enjoyed, is a good word, yeah, ordered mostly by how much I played of them, how much I enjoyed them, and really how much I could write a summary about them. Yeah, there's a lot of rearranging on that last basis. Before we get into the main list, here are some honorable mentions, as some would call them. Yeah. Torrent for its interesting aesthetics and culture-based themes. Ausenki, the World's Conquest. Not a new game, but recently released in America on PS3, features the ability to court a female Beethoven. Yeah. Pillars of Eternity, an old school RPG chocked full of story and content. I'll never be able to finish it because I can't actually grind. Layers of Fear, a true successor to PT. Hopefully it gets completed. Super Smash Bros., specifically Project M. I don't play much Smash, but when I do, I try to play a Snake, and I try to play a very hard Snake. Also, rest in peace, Project M. Hatred. Proving people do still worry about extreme ultraviolence, no matter how dumb and trivial it is. This got way more attention than it needed. Fallout 4. Not much different from Fallout 3 in New Vegas, but being newer, I get to play a lot more of it without getting sick. It does look better, and also I can build pretty much whatever I want. Just build stuff. Just go build stuff. Star Wars Battlefront. It may not be as good as Battlefront 1 and 2. Unlike other first-person shooters, it's simple and fun. I like it. It looks good. You can play as Vader. Godzilla Versus. There's an extreme lack of Godzilla games in the world. The last one before this being the one based off the movie, but it was released on mobile phones. This is pretty great. Not the greatest, pretty good. Alright, let's get down to the meat of things. Here's the list of games that I've played more, enjoyed the most, starting with number 10.
They don't exist anymore. Hope is dead. Glory is lost.
I'm not the biggest Mad Max fan. I've yet to see any of the movies, but I love the idea of an open-world post-apocalyptic game, and as a game, Mad Max is just the series that delivers that. It's a combination of the Batman Arkham series and Rage, replacing the free-flowing combat of Arkham with in-depth vehicle combat and vehicle customization. Without it, though, it would be a basic Arkham clone. It also has a basic story and suffers from being an open world, and that the game is padded with subquests to destroy towers, raid bases, and take control of territories in order to progress the story. However, it's still an open world post-apocalyptic game, and that's pretty cool. Number 9. I don't play many episodic adventure games these days, and most of them are made by Telltale, which unfortunately I'm not the biggest fan of. And then Life is Strange comes out, and without knowing anything about it, I jumped right into it, thinking it would be something people would talk about, for better or for worse. And for the most part, they did. The characters were as over-exaggerated as an American teen high school drama movie, and in the end, a lot of the choices made didn't matter like everyone wanted. It also suffered from being choice-based in that some characters' personalities are inconsistent and even change on the fly, depending on the player's choice. Obviously, the best thing about Life is Strange is the time reversal mechanic. It makes for new and more interesting puzzles than other adventure games. Life is Strange also tackles chaos theory, which is like one of five games this year that do that. Still, it was interesting playing an episodic game for the first time, waiting 2 to 3 months for the next part to be released, then making fun or hating the bad teen movie hipster dialogue.
Look at this crap. How can I show this to Mr. Jefferson?
Number 8. I don't like this game. I don't like that I can walk down a hall and see the spastic shadow of a towering ghost, turn around and it not be there. It may be because I don't play this game that often, but it still scares the shit out of me. As it should, PT was supposed to be a teaser for the then upcoming Silent Hills made by Hideo Kojima and Guillermo del Toro. It would appear though that Konami doesn't like money, as when people were getting extremely hyped for the new Silent Hill game, Konami canceled the project and pulled PT from the PSN storefront. Regardless of the controversy, PT does one thing and does it well, and that was to provide a playable tech demo of the new Fox engine and a horror setting. The graphics and themes supplement each other and provide lore and a story. The scares, while simple, are effective, and the puzzles have touches of Metal Gear Solid and Eternal Darkness. This may be higher on the list, however, it's not really a game as much as a playable teaser, and while it didn't start the trend, I imagine it helped push immensely the trend of exploration horror games with little to no gameplay and minimalistic puzzles. While this isn't necessarily a bad thing, and a few good games have and will come out of this type of game, a shit ton of bad games have come out of this in the thought that this is the evolution of horror games. It may have even been strongly believed that Silent Hills would be in this style, which I would hope would have not been the case. PT was meant to only be a tech demo of what the engine could do with horror. It's not actually related to Silent Hills. Nevertheless, it's still a good whatever it is. Number 7. Yes, yes, it's Resident Evil. My list from last year had the Resident Evil remake somewhere on the list, but, I mean, come on, it's Resident Evil. I love Resident Evil. However, Resident Evil is still Resident Evil. Resident Evil HD Remaster is the re-release of the Resident Evil remake for the GameCube, which is a remake of the original that was on PS1. And that's confusing, it's because Resident Evil has been re-released like 60 million times. HD Remaster isn't just an upscaling either. The models, background, all but the pre-rendered cutscenes have been touched up, and the game is presented in 60 FPS if one desires. One can switch between the original 4x3 or widescreen, which is just a zoom with a panning camera. There's also the option to use modern action-adventure controls, though anyone that would use that over the tank controls is an idiot who doesn't understand the necessity, albeit unfortunate, of tank controls in a game whose camera is fixed and changes on a snap in a new area. But it's there for those who complain. There are also complaints that the HD remaster added breast moving physics in the game. However, I would like to point out that the GameCube version had said physics if you look close enough. I'm not crazy. There are also new costumes. Other than that, Resident Evil Remake HD Remaster re-releases basically the same game. There's no new game modes, no new story bits, but Resident Evil is Resident Evil, and Resident Evil HD Remaster is a good Resident Evil. And I'll continue to play Resident Evil again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and hopefully never get tired of it. Number 6. In a world where survival horror games have been watered down and modernized, cameras are free-moving in first-person, puzzles are simple if not non-existent, the story is handed to you on a silver platter, and you don't fight your enemies, you run and hide. There's no doubt that most of the world would agree that the old-style survival horror is outdated and, well, shitty, some would say. Then here comes Until Dawn, almost out of nowhere, with its intense searching for story clues, fixed camera angles, and not tank controls. Now, well, 2 out of 3 ain't too bad. Until Dawn started, as many of these newfangled horror games end up, first person and fast paced, then some random shit happened and it came close to being vaporware. Now it's on the more superior PS4. I misspelled superior twice writing this. And for whatever reason, they, Supermassive Games, decided to make it a slow-paced fixed camera angle game. And it works. From what I've heard, a lot of people enjoy Until Dawn. This means that it's not dead. Just like ye old school computer RPGs like Fallout made a return with games like Wasteland 2, this game shows that old mechanic works, provided the game is good. Or maybe if they're given a break and reintroduced, which is a hint to all horror game developers, stop making horror games. You're oversaturating the market, and it's making people hate horror games, especially since 9% of them are poorly made to gain money on a genre that people are still going to buy into. But my rant's fall on deaf ears, and I'm a hypocrite, as I also want to make a horror game. But mine will be different. You'll all see. Or Until Dawn's slow pace, possibly due to its clunky, non-tank controls, only serves to intensify the horrific situation of being trapped on a cold mountain with murders and monsters and hypothermia. As stated, the controls are clunky and serve to slow down the progression. Tank controls would have fixed this, however, there isn't any real threat while running around. All life-threatening situations are done in QTE-like moments. As for graphics, it's one of the best I've seen on PS4 so far, if you ignore PT and The Order 1886, which aren't real games. Thank you. Its initial characterization in the beginning... Its initial characterization and dialogue in the beginning of the game suffers from the same problem that Life is Strange does, and that's very exaggerated and possibly campy, young adults wanting to party it up, as they say. But the most interesting thing about Until Dawn is that the monsters of the week isn't a vampire or werewolves or zombies, it's Wendigos. The Indian, or Native American, sorry, spirit of legend, creature that hasn't been touched on much in video games. Except for, like, in X2 Wolverine's Revenge. This at least gives it some originality over other horror games, which is good.
This place barely looks any different.
Yeah, nobody's been up here.
I play a lot of games in my day, because I have a lot of games to play. But some games are deserving of this list, but I don't actually play them as much as I would have liked to. So here's a very small list of games I would have liked to have played more throughout the year. Number 5. So, let's get out of the way why this is in the top 5. I'm a massive Dragon Ball fan. As with most Westerners that started watching anime in the late 90s and early 2000s, Dragon Ball was a major influence and kickstarted their enjoyment of anime. Well, that of like Sailor Moon, or Himtaro. So hearing about a new Dragon Ball game really got me going. And as a quickly adapting PC user, hearing that's coming to PC really got me going. Let's talk about it as a PC game first. Most anime games that would normally be a console game only, really any console game, but mostly the ones from Japan-based studios, have bad PC ports. Like, shit PC ports. Like, abysmal PC ports. Except for some network issues, Dragon Ball Xenoverse runs like a blessing on PC, which is even more surprising considering other Namco Bandai anime brawlers are not so great on PC. Granted, Dragon Ball Xenoverse isn't the best looking game out there, partly due to its aesthetics, but it still runs smooth at 60 plus frames per second, and no real bugs or glitches to think of. Dragon Ball Xenoverse is developed by Dimps, which, for those unaware, made the first run of PS2 Dragon Ball fighting games, the Budokai series, which are regarded by some as some of the best Dragon Ball fighting games ever. Dimps also helped with the development of Street Fighter 4. So for fans like me who looked deep into this, this meant a lot. Simply, we, or rather just I, were hoping they didn't fuck it up after the last two series of Dragon Ball fighting games, which were not made by Dimps. This is also Dimps' first 3D movement game, so if they did fuck it up, I'd at least have a reason to not internally rip into them. The fighting aspect of it's similar to the Raging Blast and Budokai Tenkaichi series of games in that it's an over-the-shoulder third person with you flying around an arena to fight your opponent, which would be not a bad thing as much as an unwanted thing, as I personally desired a more 2D, 2.5D fighting game like the Budokai series, or even an older SNES games. It would be worse, however, the story and other aspects of the game as a whole, to me, makes it feel more like an MMO action RPG, which isn't bad, as I always wanted to play Dragon Ball Online. Great segue into a story. There's a little MMORPG simply called Dragon Ball Online that I never got to play because it was never released outside China and Korea before the servers were shut down. But from what I do know about Dragon Ball Online, I can say that the plot is similar to Dragon Ball Xenoverse. Trunks fucks up the space-times and needs a warrior from out of nowhere to help him fix things. That's where the player would create their avatar. And that's the crux of the whole Dragon Ball Online and Dragon Ball Xenoverse, creating your own character in the Dragon Ball universe. Being the Super Saiyan or female Majin one always dreamed about, you then go through time and relive fights from the Dragon Ball Z, Dragon Ball GT, and the movies. Except some cute blue lady and her android, Boma I think, are messing around and making dark versions of characters to help their Dark Lord Satan Kaiojin escape purgatory. Many other elements were nipped from Dragon Ball Online, such as Trunks' main design, the character Mira Toya in the Supreme Kamen Time Space, and the idea of dark versions of characters. So is it a great Dragon Ball fighting game? Not any better than Raging Blast 2, but as a pseudo, kind of, sort of, MMORPG, it's pretty great in my opinion. My only real complaint is that there isn't dedicated race for androids like in Heroes on the 3DS, but there are workarounds for that. Number 4. What a game! Everything from the story to the gameplay is pretty exceptional despite the problems. But let's not beat around the bush, this game is clearly incomplete. The fact that it came out in such a great playable state is truly a Walpurgis Nacht miracle. But I know next to nothing as to why it's incomplete other than fuck Konami. From my experience, there were no obvious bugs to make note of. The game looks good for an open world game. The gameplay can be seen as repetitive at times, as missions eventually come off as very similar, ranging from assassinate the guy, extract the weapon, rescue the fugitive, so on and so forth, only differing in location and meeting behind said mission. It does, however, present the option to carry out missions in different ways. You can kill everyone, put everyone to sleep, extract everyone, adding them to your personal military, or sneak by everyone altogether. In the previous major release, Metal Gear Solid Peace Walkers, the boss established a non-government military for hire organization called Militaire Sans Frontières, and gives you a base known as Mother Base. You would accept missions, some of them story-based, some of them side quests. You can manage your military forces, sending them to the field to acquire more resources and build up Mother Base. This core mechanic has been carried over and expanded upon in The Phantom Pain, with Mother Base being a physical location with troops and characters around to interact with. I much enjoyed the base building aspect, something about being out to sea with my own facility really made my day. Mel Base is a thing I was excited about the most, and it delivered in my opinion. A feature was added as well that allowed other people to invade your Mother Base, leaving you to use your skills and resources to hunt them down before they could do any real damage. I was interested in this, and having the game be online most of the time can't be helped for this, but being it online all the time means that this can happen at random, even during story missions. If not dealt with, the base and resources gathered would suffer, meaning one would have to pull out of missions immediately to deal with this. This is the same problem I have with the Soul series of games. Some could interrupt the game at crucial moments, and you have no choice but to deal with it. I'm sure a lot of people like that, but as someone who primarily plays single-player games or games for the story, this kind of thing gets really annoying. Online for The Phantom Pain is riddled with other nuances, like having certain amounts of in-game currencies and resources locked to online, meaning going on offline will cause you to lose up to half of your currency and resources. Konami also tried to slyly slip in microtransactions. The only real problem with the PC version is that Metal Gear Online, which was supposed to be released in conjunction with The Phantom Pain, wasn't released for PC at the same time like it was on consoles. The biggest thing that suffers from The Phantom Pain being incomplete is the story. The story itself is primarily told through cassette tapes that the player has to actively listen to. There are a few cutscenes, but they serve more as a bridge between mission objectives. It is also said that most of the meat of the game is in the second half, however, the game throughout does a decent job catching the player up with past events, as the protagonist, Big Boss, was in a 9-year coma. And it still has all the little touches that make Metal Gear Metal Gear. While the ending of The Phantom Pain would have at least felt differently had the game shipped in a more complete state, I personally felt the ending sufficed as it tied up some loose plot points for the next game in the series, Metal Gear, for the MSX. Overall, I'm happy with what I got. I would love a complete game, but as it stands, it's not the worst thing in the world. Here's hoping Kojima and his team find a better home to make games. And fuck Konami. Number 3. Originally hinted at as Project Beast, it was assumed to be the real sequel to From Software's earlier game, Demon's Souls. That's Demon's Souls, as in the demons and the souls that they have possession of. Demons. It shouldn't have come to a surprise when it was revealed to be a completely new IP separate from Demons and Dark Souls, born from the blood of those sick with knowledge. Bloodborne is more than just a spiritual successor. Dark Souls considered the spiritual successor to Demon's Souls and Demon's Souls to Kingsfield before it, all at least take place in a similar medieval setting. Bloodborne takes place in a darker Victorian setting with a gothic architecture ripped straight out of Castlevania and its erotic horror. As if the gothic Victorian design didn't make the game seem dark and grim enough, it takes very heavy influence from Lovecraftian lore. Like Brightus, Daughter of the Cosmos is basically a Migo with a cosmos in her mouth. It's not just the creature designs that's Lovecraftic. The combination of gods, monsters, and science, and the further understanding of any of these things as to why, leads to utter madness and self-destruction. The world of Bloodborne is set in one of unknown disease and plague, with the only hint of a cause being blood, yet blood itself is sought after those who wish to ward off the sickness. Factions out in the world are set with their own goals. Hunters hunt those would-be beasts to prevent the spread of the plague and prevent their own demise at the hands of the sickness. Healing Church, in attempt to study the blood and cure the plague, stumble upon what could be greater knowledge and instead use patients as experiments to come closer to unknown divine being, creating something other than beast as a result. Vowbloods, who have taken to accepting the blood, worship it, craving it, isolate themselves from the rest of the world, as this belief is an unwelcome one.
You were at my side all along.
Like Dark Souls, the player can choose any one of these factions, or covenants as it's called in Bloodborne, to join for side quests, character bonuses, or even personal pleasure. I personally was a fan of the Vile Bloods until the Old Hunters expansion, and it introduced the Lumen Wind Kin, which allowed me to become a kin. Kin being inhuman experiments turned into gray alien-like beings in an attempt to become closer to understanding the Old Ones, as opposed to beasts, which are humans turned to monsters by the Blood Plague. Bloodborne, like Dark Souls 2, was brought to us in an easier experience in exchange for having faster gameplay. Firearms are introduced as an offhand weapon, which helps in the speed of the combat. All that said, it's still as hard and punishing as one would expect from a FromSoft game, making you lose your blood, experience, and currency upon death, leaving you to do corpse runs to retrieve them, ignore them, or eat shit trying, losing them forever. Like other Souls games, the story of Bloodborne is sacrificed for deep combat and difficult gameplay, instead leaving lore notes around the world for players to find and decipher what's happening for your own. I'm personally okay with this way of doing it. I love the feeling of discovering things in bits, knowing there's more. While it's no Order 1886, Until Dawn, or Everyone's Gone to the Rapture, all PS4 exclusives coincidentally, Bloodborne does hold its own as a good-looking game on PS4, and considering it's an open game with a large world and lots going on, it does pretty well on the graphics standpoint. It does suffer from long loading times, which has been shortened thanks to patches, but are still fairly lengthy. An SSD in one's PS4 helps, but not by much. It also suffers from slight optimization issues, as it certain situations cause the game to slow down to noticeable levels. Bugs related to the engine are still present, such as enemies falling through the world upon death, and mob animation frame rates dropping to like 10 or lower when looking at them from a distance, similar to bugs that appear in Dark Souls 2. Regardless, Bloodborne is fun and holds a special place as the third RPG I've ever beaten, ever.
Number 2.
Killed one. Cobra, I think.
Another reason to gutcha!
On April 15th, 1995, Mortal Kombat 3 was released in arcades, followed by numerous home console releases, a PC release, and various updates in the form of Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 and then Mortal Kombat Trilogy. It is my favorite Mortal Kombat. It's the one I play the most and it's the one I'm best at. Almost 20 years later, on April 14th, 2015, fuck that up, NetherRealm. NetherRealm Studios released Mortal Kombat 10, pronounced X because we're still in the 90s or something. After the successful reboot that was Mortal Kombat 9, that not only brought back the ultra-violence Mortal Kombat is known for after the embarrassment that was the PS2 era, an era that really was an embarrassment for most fighting games at the time, but also drastically changed the story. Raiden, God of Thunder, and Resident Asshole, about to die at the hands of Shao Kahn, in a clever attempt to tie the old timelines to the new one, sends a vision to his past self to not fuck it up. And what does a younger, sexier Raiden do? He fucks it up and gets half the cast killed, killing Liu Kang, the main protagonist, with his own hands. Lightning. See? Asshole. With all the characters canonically dead, or at least the ones people cared about, where does this leave a new game? With a whole cast of new characters, cause that worked out the first time. It actually works out really well this time around, as all the new characters are fun, interesting, and unique, from Bug Lady to Ninja Cowboy to Aztec Blood War Sun God. Though some new characters are just descendants of original characters who are also in the game, which isn't a bad thing. What is bad is the fact that Mortal Kombat X has less characters than previous installments, but even that is nitpicky, as a fighting game with less characters means a player can learn more from the game in less time. Mortal Kombat X does supplement this with patented combat packs, each adding 4 more fighters, 2 of which are classic characters from previous games, and the other 2 being guest characters from completely different franchises. While lots of people, including me, are eager to see what fighters NetherRealm decides to put in the future, there are many that criticize this, as the game at base costs $60, and each combat pack is around $30. Meaning the game as a whole, with the inclusion of the upcoming combat pack, is about $120. That's not including any DLC NetherRealm decides to not include in either combat packs. Controversy around paying for characters also comes from NetherRealm's promise that no paid DLC characters would be already on the disc or in the download, assuming for PC. This is not true, at least for PC, as characters such as Tanya, who you can fight against in story mode, was a DLC character part of Compact Pack 1. Many other characters you fight against in the story mode, such as Rain, Sindel, and Baraka, are playable in PC through simple modding, which, after Tanya, would make it seem like NetherRealm would plan to release these characters as DLC eventually. There was further problems with the PC release, as Mortal Kombat X was the testing dummy for a new download process on Steam, which allowed a game to download halfway and start playing. This broke the game on PC the entire night of release, as literally nothing more than the menus were playable. Once the game was downloaded, it was found to be poorly optimized. I myself at the time was unable to play it at 60 FPS unless taking the resolution down to 800x600. Funny story that I'm sure many others can relate to. After playing the story mode and unlocking a fair bit of content on my own, the first DLC character, Jason Voorhees, was released along with a would-be optimization patch. The patch unfortunately wiped the save data of the game, saved the DLC character, and Shinnok for some reason was unlocked from the start despite being a story mode character for me. NetherRealm responded to this by taking away the DLC and the patch. This, however, did not reverse the lost save data, so everyone affected was granted with Unlock Everything in the Crypt DLC, which why such a thing existed is beyond me, but I can't complain.
Do you?
And quite impudent.
Round one, fight!
But I rant far too long about how shit Mortal Kombat is for a game I put in my top 5. Most of these problems are only on PC, not like Batman Arkham Knight released 2 months later, which had problems across all platforms and still runs like OS on a decent PC. Warner, what the fuck, really? You fuck up all your game releases. Except for like Scribblenauts. And this can be attributed to the fact that NetherRealm outsourced the PS3, 360, and PC port to another studio, which couldn't even put out the PS3 and 360 versions and had to cancel them altogether. Wrapping this up, the new characters are great, the graphics are the same as expected when you use the same engine as the previous game. The sound effects are gross in a good way, if not sounding a bit like a sewage system, and more characters are more than welcome. The only real crime Mortal Kombat X has committed is killing off Melina in the story. And Ed Boon's a liar.
PC, it's not going to be an awful port. You guys are going to make sure it's awesome. Going to be as good as the console.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much.
And now the moment you've all been waiting for or dreading, you know, if you're dreading this moment, I'm not sure why you stuck around, but for whatever reason, the top five, game of this list, the number one, not the five, the one, yeah. Number one. After the admittedly enjoyable train wreck that was both Resident Evil 6 and Resident Evil Operation Raccoon City, in the same year, Capcom, probably thinking they're on a roll, decided to make a game exclusive to the 3DS, because the Mercenaries 3D was a huge success. This time they offset some of the development to Tosei, who I think are most known for making the Game & Watch stuff. Just think, Resident Evil on a Game & Watch. Anyways, Resident Evil Revelations was released the same year, but in between 6 and Orc. And compared to those two, this game is amazing. It was looking like Resident Evil was returning to form, at least the form of Resident Evil 4. It was slow-paced, creepy, and lacked the action in the beginning to add to the creepiness, followed by a notion of, alright, it's time to finally end this, but we only have 5 minutes, as in true Resident Evil fashion.
My name is Jill Valentine.
The scarcity of health and ammo in the return of Jill Valentine. I love Jill Valentine. However, later down the line, especially with the release of the very blatantly successful Resident Evil HD remaster and the rumors of a Resident Evil 2 remake and Resident Evil 0 HD remaster, people started to disown Revelations and return to begging for old-school Resident Evil. Out comes Revelations 2, crawling out from under the dregs of the recently released Resident Evil HD remaster, with the subtitle Revelations attached to it, many were weary that it would be another shoot-bang. However, in a world where the style of the original Resident Evil, fixed camera angles, set control, and whatnot are considered outdated, and Resident Evil 4 is considered one of the best Resident Evil ever, Resident Evil Revelations is a good continuation of the series, which may be an irony as Revelations 2 canonically takes place between 5 and 6. Like the first Revelations, this game, in my opinion, attempts to return Resident Evil to the last time the series was good, while staying modern. It's slow-paced, creepy in the beginning, and action-packed right at the end just when everyone is sick of the antagonist's bullshit. But it also improves and evolves from the first Revelations. It's not just creepy compared to the more action horror that it is 5 and 6. The story is, at least in my opinion, a bit darker this time around. It still holds the base mode of, there's a new something, this time's a virus, but it has been parasites before. A clearly psychotic yet outwardly influential and charismatic antagonist that desires longevity in life and possibly world domination, and a series of traps and puzzles for the protagonists as they make their way to a bazooka battle with the eventually mutated antagonist monster abomination. But the antagonist isn't just laying traps for self-protection in a paranoid attempt to ward off would-be spies. They're selecting specific victims for specific reasons or torturing and testing their will and constitution. Imagine someone forcing a cyanide pill in your throat and told you not to swallow, and they made you run a maze and murder a family member every time you hit a dead end. That's what's happening in Revelations 2. It also features a cast of new and returning characters that's basically fan service. Revelations had Jill Valentine and Chris Redfield, but was padded out with new characters that come out of nowhere and are easily forgettable. Revelations 2 features the return of Barry Burton as the star of the entire game. Fine, Claire Redfield also makes a return as the secondary main character. Secondary. A lot of the other new characters suffer from the same as Revelations in that they're somewhat unimportant, but two of the new main characters, Moira and Alex, are actually a warm welcome. Moira Burton, the daughter of Barry and Claire's companion, while has the dialogue of, well, fuck, life is strange. See, just being there adds a well of backstory to Barry. Those in the know of Resident Evil know that Barry is a family man who had two daughters. Daughters who were held at gunpoint by former antagonist Albert Wesker. Before the release of Revelations 2, it was known that Moira, despite the desperate, life-threatening situation, was strongly opposed to using guns. It was speculated that this was because of the hostage situation she and her sister were put under at young age. But it was much worse than that. One would wonder why the daughter of a funny, loving family man, Barry, would turn into a bat-mouthed, father-hating rebel. One could even ask, if they're paying attention, what's Moira's sister doing if Moira is part of a non-government world peace organization? She's dead. Moira's sister's dead. And Moira shot her. With Barry's gun. Spoilers. Sorry. Not only does this give a significant piece of backstory to Barry, but it's a dark piece of backstory. Their character, the antagonist, Alex Wesker, the twin sister of Albert Wesker. Saying they're twins is an understatement, as they're both generic freaks in nature designed to be the perfect being. 13 in total, it was thought that all the clones but Albert died, as clones are known to do, though DLC for Resident Evil 5 hinted that there might have been one other survivor. Capcom also hinted, saying that the antagonist for Revelations 2 was someone real fans knew but hasn't been seen. However, other than her connection to Albert, Alex doesn't really do anything outstanding except recite Kafka all the time. One more new character is Barry's partner, Natalia. For most of the game, she's just a useless little girl that, despite having the ability to sense enemies and has amazing stealth, does less than Moira, in my opinion. Her most importance is towards the end when it becomes obvious that she has some sort of connection to Alex.
Now you can call me Alex.
This being said, Revelations 2 brings the return of multiple endings based on choices made in the game. That being said, there's only one choice made that changes the ending, and it's fairly easy to miss. The last thing is that Revelations 2 is presented in an episodic manner, which feels like it's unnecessarily following a trend, but gets away with it as each episode was released weekly, though that makes the whole thing seem even more pointless. Wowzers, what a great list. 2015, just chock full of big games and stuff. But now it's over, and we have to look forward to the next year and its series of games. I hope everyone enjoys, and I'll see you in the future. Hopefully the very, very far future. Like, 2937. Yep. Look forward to 2937. The robots take over.